Muy buenas tardes, mi nombre es Mauro Basaure y es un honor para mí hoy día estar acá con nuestra invitada Renata Salekel y tener esta labor de combinar, ¿no? Discurso, su presentación con las preguntas de ustedes. Ese va a ser mi rol básicamente. Cuando ya termine, vamos a ver un tiempo para preguntas. Alrededor de 3 preguntas. Vamos a estar una hora hoy día conversando con Renata. El conversatorio de hoy, ¿no? Con esta destacada socióloga y filósofa eslovena, Renata Salesl, ¿no? ¿Correcto? Tiene como nombre El poder de la envidia y los celos hoy, ¿sí? De esas emociones negativas, fuertes, sociales, que involucran siempre a un otro, ¿no? Y que pueden dar paso muchas veces a la hostilidad, a la tragedia, como también quedó expresado en el Otelo de William Shakespeare, como ustedes saben, ¿no? ¿Es más arriba? Perfecto, sorry. Bueno, yo diría que Renata Salekel es una de las mentes más brillantes que ha entregado Ljubljana, la capital de Eslovenia, donde ella además es profesora. Entiendo que Ljubljana es una universidad fundada en la época de Tito, ¿no? Ella es ahí, hace de filósofa, socióloga, teoría crítica de la cultura, teórica crítica de la cultura. Es reconocida por sus trabajos en el campo del psicoanálisis, la teoría crítica, la sociología del derecho. La obra de Renata, que yo conozco y que ustedes van a encontrar a la salida también en libros que ya va a tener un tiempo también para firmar, yo tengo la impresión que tiene una característica fundamental, ¿ya? Y es que con maestría ella usa conceptos claves del psicoanálisis, fundamentalmente del psicoanálisis lacaniano, conceptos como fantasía, goce o jouissance, para realizar un análisis crítico de la sociedad moderna. Ese es como, si ustedes quieren, en 2 palabras, el trabajo que ella y el aporte que realiza a nuestra comprensión de las sociedades modernas. Es decir, desde el psicoanálisis, ella se enfoca en tratar cuestiones claves de las sociedades modernas. Yo elegí un par de textos para presentarles, los van a encontrar afuera en su versión castellana, ¿no? En 1994, Los botines de la libertad, The Spoil of Freedom, los botines en el sentido de los botines de guerra, ¿no? ¿Sí? Una cita de ese libro: en el acto de perseguir la libertad encontramos una serie de imposibilidades que revelan cómo el sujeto está atrapado en sus propias fantasías inconscientes. En Perversiones del amor y del odio de 1998, dice: el amor y el odio son tan opuestos, no son tan opuestos como aparecen, sino 2 caras en realidad de la misma moneda. Ambos son modos de relacionarnos con el otro. En el libro Ansiedad de 2004, dice: la ansiedad en realidad es un reflejo de la falta en el interior del sujeto, un vacío que busca llenarse con respuestas imposibles. En La tiranía de la elección de 2010, dice: cuanto más creemos que podemos elegir, menos somos capaces en realidad de afrontar el peso de esas decisiones, y en lugar de liberarnos, quedamos atrapados en una ansiedad constante. En El placer de la transgresión, su último libro, también traducido, dice: el acto de transgredir no es siempre una búsqueda de liberación, a menudo es una forma de sujetarse aún más firmemente a las reglas que pretendemos romper. El psicoanálisis finalmente le ayuda para encontrar estas especies de paradoja que producen un efecto de reflexión enorme en nosotros respecto de nuestras propias experiencias, ¿sí? De manera que, y con esto termino, cuando hablamos de el odio y la envidia, que es el título de hoy, lo que debiésemos esperar en realidad, más que un análisis interiorista de la experiencia personal, es cómo ellas, esas emociones, están trabajando en el sentido de formas de poder, de análisis de la sociedad en su conjunto. Eso, le doy la palabra a Renata y les pido un aplauso para ella antes de comenzar para cantar.
Thank you, Mauro. the organization of Puerto de Ideas, especially Chantal Signoro for inviting me. I would also like to thank Universitat Andreas Bello, and especially the PhD program in critical theory, which is led by Mauro, which also contributed to this possibility that I'm able to visit your fantastic country, which I already visited 2 times before and have always enjoyed the intellectual exchanges here. So I'm going to share with you some of my newest work, where I'm looking at the emotions in contemporary society. And often when we are speaking about jealousy and also envy to a point, we perceive them as individual feelings. However, I think that both of these feelings, emotions, have a very important social dimension. Now, on the one hand, jealousy is really important in socialization. You know, when we are growing up, in some way we have to go through the feelings of jealousy already as little children. And in some way, the way we deal with jealousy is marked always by society, by language, by culture in which we live. So, what I want to point out also is jealousy, although it's a very individual feeling, is nonetheless very much exploited by ideology. So already here we can see that consumerism, you know, from early on plays kind of on the feeling of jealousy. And it also later on in life entices us, you know, to constantly consume, buy more and more. Now, racist and sexist and also nationalist ideologies also profit both from jealousy and envy when we perceive that others are enjoying at our expense. Now, envy and jealousy towards others are, however, often perceived in a paradoxical way. So, in regard to the migrants, we sometimes say that they are lazy, but almost, you know, equally we accuse them that they are stealing our jobs, that they are kind of too active. Now, in the recent years, we have experienced, especially in the developed Western cultures, a certain kind of a change in the perceptions of jealousy, especially jealousy in private lives. There has been a lot of public debate that we need to go beyond old taboos and that we need to sort of maybe try to kind of, let's say, rethink love life and family structures. You know, those who advocate polyamorous relationships like to say that they are not jealous when partners have intimate relationships with other people. But if, on the one hand, it is sort of stressed that jealousy in love relationship should be, in a way, reduced, on the other hand, there has been quite big intolerance on a society level towards how other people are organizing their lives. Which is why we see actually more elements of jealousy and envy in this kind of a social setting, in the hostility towards migrants, homosexuals, and those who advocate a more fluid relationship, a more fluid attitude towards sexual differences. Quite often, we are hostile towards what in Lacanian psychoanalysis we are calling the jouissance of the other. The English translation, enjoyment, is a bit too positive. The French term uses, you know, kind of the pleasure in pain also as the meaning of this enjoyment. Now, jealousy and envy are often used interchangeably. Sometimes, you know, we kind of mix them up. But some definitions say that jealousy is more often in a way linked to, you know, sort of like the intersubjective relationships, and they involve a possibility of loss. Now, already Freud was speaking that jealousy might emerge in early childhood when, you know, a child gets brother or sister. And, you know, later Freud was also speaking, and Melanie Klein and other psychoanalysts, you know, about this kind of an envious relationship that also develops here, where the little child does not necessarily want to still suck from mother's milk, but is intolerant towards observing the enjoyment that the baby brother or sister is getting from, you know, sort of sucking from mother's milk. So some are saying that jealousy and envy differ in the way that, you know, in envy we might have a kind of a more of a question of, do I sort of want an object or also a status? And they perceive it more as a kind of a dyadic relationship, like a person and something that the person would like to have. And jealousy more as a kind of a triadic relationship, a person and a rival who might take something away from the person. Now, Israeli philosopher Aaron Ben-Ziv sees jealousy as something very personal, something that makes us more vulnerable than envy. However, French psychoanalyst Claude Trapon, on the other hand, describes jealousy as a murderous emotion. After all, in law, we talk about murders being motivated by jealousy. Some take jealousy as a kind of a primary emotion out of which envy might arise. While many psychoanalysts see envy actually as more aggressive than jealousy. Now, how does this look like? When we are jealous, we might wish to have what others are having, or we don't want to lose what we are having. Let's say our lover, you know, we don't want to lose our lover, or, you know, we want to have someone else. But when we are envious, some psychoanalysts are saying, we might not want to wish what the others is having, but rather we want to destroy the pleasure that someone is getting from something. Let's say that I'm envious of my neighbor who has such a car. You know, I'm not a big car person. I drive, but cars are something, you know, I barely know 3 or 4 different types of cars. But, you know, this is a nice car. So it might be that I'm envious of this car, although it's not so much that I want to have this car, but, you know, I'm jealous, you know, and sort of primarily envious also of the enjoyment that my neighbor is getting driving, you know, a red car, and I love red color. So it might be that I would get a pleasure fantasizing that my neighbor's car gets ruined and taken away. So it's not that I want to have this car, I just can't stand, you know, my neighbor enjoying it. So this would be one of the kind of psychoanalytic take on envy, where we don't necessarily want to have what the other has, but we are, you know, perturbed seeing how they are enjoying. Now, I will look at this question of jealousy and envy also in regard, you know, to the political situation. So both emotions play a role in the way society functions. Now, jealousy does not necessarily kind of emerge when, you know, people have direct contact with each other. Jealousy might also sort of in our private life emerge over the questions of who are we, let's say, in society, but also for the other. In the Lacanian psychoanalysis, we are using the term the big other, the social symbolic setting, but also sort of another human being. We are constantly wondering, you know, what is the desire of the other, who are we for the other, like another human being, but also who are we in society as such. And here, you know, both those feelings, jealousy and envy, play an important role. Now, we might be in personal lives, you know, jealous of people we never met. However, as I will try to exemplify, we might even be jealous at dead people. Let me give you a story. I knew a woman, I will call her Maria, who, you know, years ago dated a man I will call Joe. Now, this woman, Maria, worked very hard. She spent, you know, a lot of hard-earned money on this partner, Joe. Joe was engaged in a kind of an artistic, creative profession, didn't really work, but didn't kind of, let's say, also earn any money. So this woman was paying for a lot of his things, and they themselves kind of enjoyed spending weekends together. They were taking trips often with a car that she bought, and so on. Now, the man was quite moody, a bit depressed, critical of her not being an intellectual, not being educated, and so on. And after about 8 years, the woman had enough of this kind of relationship. She decided she terminated it, left Joe, totally rationally, but they continued to be friends. So twice a year they would maybe meet, they would write occasional messages, and occasionally this good woman was still supporting Joe financially when he needed some small help. Now, a moment came when the man wanted that she buys him a new computer. She refused. She said, I have an old computer which I can give you. But he said, no, I really like new computers. So that was kind of the end of that, you know, vague friendship that continued. She pretty much stopped the communication, lived, let's say, her life normally until, you know, the man became ill. Now, when the man fell ill gravely with cancer, you know, they reconnected, she visited him when he was sort of like in the hospice. They spent a few hours together, and then a woman appears, I would call her Linda, who says, I'm Joe's wife. Now, Maria had no idea where is this woman from. And the woman said, yes, I was like a friend from student years. We reconnected in the last month, and we got married in hospice. So, you know, knowing that the man was dying, you know, this woman got married for pretty much practical reasons. Now, after Joe's death, Maria fell in a deep depression. She started feeling that she didn't help the man enough. She couldn't stop crying, she could not eat, she felt, you know, enormous sort of guilt that, you know, she wasn't more present in the last years of this man's life, although basically they had really no kind of connections anymore. But more and more, she became extremely jealous of Linda. You know, how come that this woman married a man on the deathbed? And although it appeared like a pragmatic relationship for both, Linda was able to take over a state-owned apartment. You know, Joe was finally had someone who took care of his artistic pursuit, put them on Instagram and so on. Maria could not function anymore because of the jealousy over, you know, this dead man's relationship, you know, in the last weeks of his life with Linda. Now, Maria, in a way, became also obsessed with money, Suddenly she started calculating how much money she spent on the man, you know, and you know how much sort of money the other woman might profit and so on. Now, when Maria split from Joe, she never regretted this decision. It was only after his death that the old wounds opened. Now, although Maria was comfortable in her life, had her own house and so on, she could not stand that, you know, the other woman profited and got, you know, the state-owned little apartment as a married woman. Maria refused to come to the memorial to the that Linda organized for Joe. She also kind of couldn't stand the fact that suddenly Joe's work was promoted on Instagram. Now, why this jealousy over like a dead man? Here we have an example of the question of who am I for the other. So for this woman, what provoked the feeling of jealousy was that the rival, in a way, got a certain kind of a symbolic recognition, and that the rival also sort of played kind of a role in, you know, her ex-boyfriend. So the rival also took over, you know, Joe when he died. So the rival became a kind of a possessor also of Joe's afterlife. And, you know, suddenly Maria had to deal with the question of what role did she play in this dead man's life decade ago. So we can see that emotion of jealousy, you know, might not even have to do with a real threat in our lives. It can be a fantasy, and the pain over the question of who am I for the other, you know, that kind of opens this wound. Now, on society levels, we can observe, you know, the role of jealousy and envy, especially in societies which are very corrupt or which are run by authoritarian leaders. And I would like to explore with you what role these two emotions play in, you know, the example of Russia. But the example could have been in any other country which is, you know, illiberal or, you know, has kind of a corruption in the poor of society. Now, in authoritarian or authoritarian leaning society, you know, often people become at some point apathetic, feeling that nothing can change, that the system might continue forever. Also, the societies that are, for example, very much based on corruption, people might become very passive, they might retreat into their private lives, their family lives. And on the outside, it looks as if, you know, majority of people are just, you know, not very active, don't care that much. However, this society very much rely on people finding a way to cheat the system, to sort of, you know, find a way to circumvent the rules. And jealousy here often plays an important role. Through jealousy and envy, people often express their anger, not necessarily at the system, but often, you know, sort of at the themselves, that they were not so skillful in circumventing the rules. Now, in this kind of societies, you know, we can observe, for example, that, you know, people become very cunning, which means, you know, that they kind of know how the system are working, which is why Russian analyst of the public opinion, Yuri Nevada, he was kind of persecuted at the time of the socialist regime and the post-socialist regime. He was one of the first people in Russia who started seriously studying public opinion. And Yuri Nevada said that the main feature mentality that developed in his country was precisely this kind of cunning, to be cunning, to be a trickster. So he said that people on the outside looked passive, apathetic, but you know, they very much privately were extremely active. They were very wise and resourceful in finding the way to cheat the system. Now, Levada also observed when the socialist system collapsed and the post-socialist system emerged, for some moment there was a feeling that society might turn into a democratic direction, but very soon with Putin coming to power, you know, people lost kind of hope that democracy might emerge. At that time, Levada points out, people became even more cynical, you know, even more distrustful towards the regime and towards each other. And at the same time, there was a rise in envy of those who succeeded economically. So those who succeeded economically were not respected, but they were envied. They were envied because they appeared better in tricking the system. So they were better in cheating, and that's why, you know, people were not respected, you know, because of their wealth. They were just, you know, sort of, let's say, more skillful in circumventing the rules. Now, in a society where there is no longer a secret that, for example, lies and cheating leads to success, apathy on the outside looks like lack of interest in political struggle, like accepting that the regime will just continue as it is, that, you know, there is nothing that can change. But in private, people become quite active in seeking ways to outwit the system and the other people. So when people kind of deal with cunning attitudes every day, they have no respect for others because the others are just, you know, more immoral and cruel. So one might be jealous and envious of these people, but we would not admire them. Now, when people expect nothing more than fraud, they are also not ashamed when they are cunning. However, they become angry at themselves, you know, when they are kind of too cynical or when they become too idealistic. So envy in this case paradoxically functions as something that pacifies people. It helps them to conform to the way the system functions and prevents them to see the kind of the broader picture of the system in which they live. Now, a social aspect of, you know, envy can also be observed at times of crisis. And let me give you an example of how, you know, these emotions, envy and also jealousy, played out at the time of the pandemics. You remember probably that when the pandemic started, we were told that we are all in the same boat. However, it quickly became clear that some people were on the yachts and others were in kind of small perforated, you know, dinghies. So we can say that, you know, this envy and jealousy started quite quickly, especially when people, you know, during the lockdowns, you know, observed how, you know, the wealthy experienced very differently the lockdown. In France, a big scandal emerged when the writer Leila Slimani, and it was almost at the same time that another writer, Marie Daruesque, but it was Leila Slimani who was kind of the first, started publishing in Le Monde a diary of how her lockdown looked like. So this was a diary that Leila Slimani started publishing in Le Monde, and she described how wonderful it was during lockdown that she went with her children to her country's house. She took photos of the surrounding, and she kind of described, you know, that she was telling her children that, you know, it was sort of like a fairy tale, like a story of the Sleeping Beauty, that they should experience, you know, this moment of lockdown and being in nature. Now, the other writer, Marie Dariusz, also confessed in Le Point that when she came to her holiday home, she locked her car, the Parisian car with the Parisian plate, into a garage and started driving around with kind of an old car with a local plate, so that people might not be jealous of her, you know, coming from Paris. Now, on French social networks, people became furious over those diaries, over these reports. Poor people started posting pictures of their views from their cramped small apartments, where they mostly saw just the walls, you know, and kind of nothing spectacularly. And of course, anger and jealousy towards the rich who moved to the villages, you know, started provoking the villagers to the point that some villagers started putting posters around their village which said, don't bring your virus with you. Go home, go back to your cities and take the virus with you too. Now, American writer Leslie Jameson described at the time of the pandemic her jealousy towards others. Now, she, when she suffered from COVID-19 as a single mother, she was sort of enclosed in her apartment, feeling quite ill, barely surviving. And, you know, she said, virus became my partner, you know, sort of like a third companion in this apartment. And then she said she started looking through the window and saw high school students, you know, who were walking hand in hand, in groups, you know, who kind of appeared as if they do not care. She said she was tempted to yell out of the window at the reckless youngsters, so jealous she was. How dare they walk around? But then she felt, I have to stop moralizing about people's disregard for social distancing, because actually my moralizing is the way I am dealing with my own fears. Now, in Slovenia, my home country, there were a lot of jealousies over people who were transgressing or, you know, didn't really care about the prohibitions, especially at shopping malls. You know, people were putting notes in the cars, you know, which appeared with the plates from different municipalities, like, why did you come, you know, to our part of the city or our part of the country? Don't you know that it is prohibited, and so on? So there were lots of kind of those kind of anger attacks in the shopping malls. But the biggest problem was our beautiful lake. So we have a very beautiful lake in the Alpine region, and some people during the lockdown went to walk around the lake. Now, it was as if our media was obsessed with these people. The media was constantly trying to capture, you know, people who were walking around the lake, and they were maybe from a different city. They were not supposed to be at this lake. The mayor of the lake didn't like people coming from other part. So, you know, this obsession about someone enjoying at that time when we are supposed to be in the lockdown was really kind of, I would say, guiding the sentiments of a lot of people during the pandemic. Now, Sigmund Freud, in his time, spoke in the work Group Psychology and Analysis of Ego about the problem of how do we form social, the idea of kind of group social spirit. What connects sort of people, and how do, you know, people actually perceive social justice? Freud's idea was that people perceive themselves equal when they feel that no one stands out and for who they are or what they have. But Freud said that the demand for equality is in a way the foundation of social consciousness and the sense of duty. And then he says that social justice actually means that we deny ourselves many things so that others will be without them too. So in some way, we limit ourselves hoping that others will limit themselves too. Freud actually then says that social justice, the idea of social justice, comes from envy. Now, he takes the example of people infected by syphilis, who say consciously that they are afraid of infecting other people. Now, their fear not to infect other people, according to Freud, is associated with an unconscious desire to actually spread infection to others. People are, in a way, pondering, why am I infected and cut from the world and others are not? So Freud says that there is this, you know, kind of a feeling of jealousy and envy related to, you know, kind of when we are infected. However, because of socialization, we repress those feelings. So when we form group spirit, we reverse hostile feelings towards positive social ties. And, you know, we are trying not to infect others, although unconsciously, you know, we might want to. Now, this reversal of feelings often emerges in a group where we have, you know, kind of strong emotional ties among ourselves and also with our leaders. We perceive, you know, leaders as being part of the group, but also a little bit outside. Now, in the study of the group psychology, Freud highlights the military and, you know, the religious groups, the church. And his point is that the identification, kind of brotherly feelings among soldiers and other group members too, emerge when they feel to be treated equally by the leader. Now, when this doesn't happen, quite often the structures might start collapsing. If we take this Freudian theory to the society in general, especially, let's say, society struggling with a big crisis like it was pandemic, we can say that in these situations, we could observe that the leaders in many countries, you know, stopped treating people equally and started privileging themselves and their friends. In many countries, you know, people close to the leadership started benefiting from business deals, buying, you know, vaccines or protective materials, and so on. And this affected the group spirits in society. I would also say globally, it was a huge mistake that the developed Western countries did not share freely, you know, the vaccines early on with the more impoverished part of the world, especially, let's say, the global South, and they did not also sort of open the possibility that, you know, the poorer countries could quickly manufacture the vaccines. Now, we can say that when this in the moment of crisis, you know, the leaders of the world, but also the leaders in individual countries, appear to be sort of kind of obsessed only with their interests, we saw that primarily they were, you know, sort of, let's say, abandoning the people, and we, in a way, saw also a certain kind of distrust, not only towards leaders, but also among people, to kind of, let's say, emerge much more strongly than if you have a kind of an idea of social justice guiding the society. Now, in my concluding part, let me give a little kind of story outside of, let's say, political, social dimension. I will take some example of how envy and jealousy can play an important role also in art. Now, Francis Bacon, famous British painter, said that he actually loves envy. He said that he likes when there is envious relationship among artists. And Bacon also said that, in a way, true friendship for him relies on a kind of a power of destruction. He said that he doesn't like if his friends are praising his work, but he prefers if they are criticizing him. And, you know, with his words are, in a way, destroying his work. Now, early in the career, Bacon became very friendly with another famous British artist, Lucien Freud, who felt from early on great jealousy towards Bacon. You know, envy and jealousy between these two painters, you know, started kind of early on, but, you know, it continued in quite dramatic ways. Now, at some point, early in the career, Bacon sold this painting for just £80 to his friend, Lucien Freud. Lucien Freud decided to put it somewhere in the storage in his house and never allowed any museum to exhibit it. No one was allowed to, let's say, take this and show it to the public. Now, a moment came in 1985 when Francis Bacon got the first opportunity for a major retrospective in the Tate Museum. Lucien Freud refused the request that this painting should be exhibited at this, you know, exhibition. Now, Bacon was, of course, hurt. They stopped, in a way, communicating. And in a way, we can say what Freud's jealousy showed was, you know, that, you know, he couldn't deal with the social recognition that his friend would get with a big show at stake. So it was an, you know, aggressive feeling. Now, Freud tried to make, in some way, a dent in the social recognition of his friend. It was kind of a capricious punishment. He was trying to ruin the enjoyment Bacon was getting from the big event. Now, Freud also, in a way, showed, you know, kind of envy in the refusal, you know, just to kind of be part also of this show. So he didn't want to even come to the opening and so on. But then a reversal happened, you know, when Lucien Freud had his own big show, he invited Francis Bacon to the opening and to a special dinner, and at that time, you know, Francis Bacon refused. He didn't want to show recognition. Now, Lucien Freud was a big womanizer. He had 14 children, at least 14 children, with many different women. He had affairs with his models and his students, and, you know, he kind of, let's say, had a very particular jealous type of a relationship with those students who became skilled in painting. So one of the partners of Lucien Freud, Celia Paul, wrote a memoir in which she describes that Lucien Freud, when they were dating, she was his student, he was much older, at some point asked her to stop painting. Lucien Freud told her that she should stop painting while she is in relationship with him, because he was impressed how a young artist, Gwen Jones, gave up painting when she was in a relationship with Auguste Rodin, the famous French sculptor. Rodin was much older than Gwen Jones, and the Rodin's idea was that when Gwen Jones was in relationship with him, she should stop painting and just enjoy being entirely in the experience of love with the great master. Now, Celia Paul refused Freud. She explains that she did so because she imagined that about 25 years before, Lucien Freud probably told the same story to his former student lover, Susie Boyd, who was in love with him at that time, and who actually agreed with this request and stopped painting. Now, Celia Paul is recognized today as one of the most important British painters of today's times. Now, she's not recognized anymore just, you know, as a Freudian muse. She had painted many portraits and self-portraits, and one of them is this one, Lucien and Me, which she painted many years after Lucien already died. And in some way, we can see in this image tenderness between the two, you know, former lovers. We don't see sort of, let's say, kind of, let's say, jealousy or envy in a way expressed in the painting. Now, let me conclude. Often, we perceive envy with the help of colors. We describe it often as green. You know, someone is green with envy, or envy is a monster with green eyes. Now, the green is related to nature, to growth, which is not coincidence that, you know, we perceive envy as green. Most of the time, we envy someone's prosperity and the fact that they have something that we don't have. Aristotle, for example, said that envy is the pain we feel at the happiness of others. Now, even when we associate envy sort of with colors, you know, we have to say that it is not only kind of green. Sometimes we associate envy with yellow. There is a lot of envy in this novel, The Great Gatsby, and in the movie. So there is like a yellow car. There is a lot of sort of gold. And, you know, we also have, I don't know if this will work, but it was a little, I don't know if this works. Maybe I'm not so skilled. Okay, anyhow, it was a little excerpt of the envy that we showed, that is showed against the main character in Great Gatsby when someone observes his beautiful car. Now, in Russian language, we, however, have two other types of colors in associated with envy. We speak about black envy, and we speak about white envy. Now, why these two different colors? White envy is supposed to be sort of envy which we feel at the pain in regard to a lack, our lack of wealth or youth or strength, and we wish and yearn to regain it. You know, in some way, we kind of want to enjoy what others are having, which is why Russians perceive white envy as it's quite helpful. Let's say if Mauro writes a wonderful book, you know, I might develop white envy, feeling, you know, why are you so lazy and you didn't speed up your own writing? So it might be like a creative envy, you know, which pushes me to work harder. Now, Masha Gessen, American-Russian journalist, says that white envy in Russia is perceived like, I want to be you, while black envy is like, it should be me, not you. So black envy in Russian context is mean and resentful. It affirms kind of a more despotent view of the world than one white envy. So white envy offers hope, and black is kind of destructive. Masha Gessen, in an interesting way, brought these terms, white envy and black envy, to how Russians perceived Ukrainian Maidan revolution in 2014, you know, during the Maidan revolution, the Ukrainians were able to force out of power the authoritarian pro-Russian leader Viktor Yanukovych. And when the Russians observed the Ukrainian revolution, the path that was opened to democratization of the society, Masha Gessen says there was a lot of white envy, a good envy, thinking that something like this might be also possible in Russia. At that time, you know, people were feeling maybe finally the opposition will able to organize, overturn the Putin regime. So there was a hope in regard to the change in their country, and that was kind of the white envy at that time. Of course, things did not realize like this. In 2022, when Russia attacked Ukraine, it was the black envy that started sort of kind of emerging. It was kind of a much more of a destructive feeling. Now, while envy can sometimes, you know, sort of lead to violence and destructions, jealousy, in a way, often can have quite positive effects. Birmingham professor of ethics, Christian Christianson, argues that actually we shouldn't take jealousy as negative emotion. His idea is that sometimes we perceive jealousy as a sign of corrupt mind or some kind of a pathological, psychological condition that needs to be treated. And however, his idea is that what if we look at jealousy in a positive way, as something, you know, that might actually sort of, let's say, open nonetheless a certain kind of a particular relationship to others. Now, of course, some are saying that envy might be more kind of a horrible relationship than jealousy, but, you know, as we said, with white and black envy, there can also be a kind of a positive element in envy too. Now, let me go back to jealousy. What might be the most positive thing about jealousy? Now, jealousy, in a way, is linked to the desire for recognition and for respect, which is why it is fundamentally a social emotion. Now, throughout the history, many psychoanalysts, you know, sort of have looked at this question of how early in childhood, you know, we deal with both feeling of envy and jealousy. Jacques Lacan put forward a thesis that, you know, in some way, jealousy becomes a critical emotion in the moment of socialization, because suddenly, you know, at that time, you know, when we start experiencing jealousy, we start identifying in a new way with other people. On the one hand, in some way, a child experiencing jealousy needs to deal with the desire of the other. Let's say the big brother might, you know, be bothered by the desire of the little brother. In a way, we, from the moment of childhood, when we experience jealousy, we need to take into account that it's not only ourselves who have desires, but others have them too. Now, which is why jealousy is an important part of socialization. Now, while envy and jealousy are often looked negatively, my concluding point is that they shouldn't be looked at negatively as such. In some way, with jealousy, we understand the logic of the lack in the other and the lack in ourselves, and also the problem of the social kind of, let's say, lack antagonism and the question of who are we in society. With envy, however, we also get an opportunity to make out of ourselves something, which is what, like, the white type of envy might lead to. Now, envy can also be encouraged like an element of encouragement on the level of society. When the countries observe the direction of other countries, there is kind of a difference in the type of envy they develop towards them. They have, in a way, a choice to develop destructive black envy or white envy, which might motivate positive social change. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Gracias, Renata. Bueno, ustedes se dan cuenta que una de las cuestiones fascinantes del trabajo de Renata es este viaje entre cuestiones de emociones, psicoanálisis, sociedad, temas de justicia, de guerra, etcétera, ¿no? Eso me hace, de arte también, ¿no? Eso me hace pensar que seguramente hay preguntas. Tenemos algunos momentos para, unos 10 minutos me dicen más o menos, para poder conversar con Renata. Les pido que sean ojalá breves para poder dar un espacio de discusión. Mientras reunimos las preguntas, acá hay una, ¿sí? Estaba pensando dos cosas, Renata, mientras reunimos las preguntas, ¿sí? Acá hay una, no sé si está por ahí el micrófono, ¿sí? Que finalmente la envidia, estaba pensando mientras hablabas, yo no conocía esta conversación, ¿no? Este discurso de Renata, que finalmente la envidia es, en nuestra cultura es un pecado capital dentro del mundo católico, ¿no? ¿Estás aquí? De manera que esta visión con la que terminas tú, ¿no? De tratar de aceptar, como en general lo haces en tus libros, ¿no? De la aceptación y no esta visión moralista respecto de ciertas emociones, me cae bien. Me parece muy interesante. Lo otro es recordaba un concepto que usan los alemanes, creo que existe también en otras culturas, que es el concepto de Schadenfreude, que es esta idea de alegrarse por el daño del otro, ¿no? Que es algo que ellos parecen reconocer como parte de la vida cotidiana, ¿no? Como, sí, lo usan mucho, de hecho, ¿no? Y reconocen ese sentimiento. Estaba solamente tirando algunas ideas mientras, para ver si podemos partir por acá. Que hay una pregunta ya, sí, por favor. Tu nombre, sí.
Mi nombre, here. Ok, thank you for your presentation. Voy a hablar en español mejor. ¿Qué rol ves tú de las redes sociales en la envidia? ¿Un efecto positivo o un efecto negativo?
No sé si hay otra pregunta por ahí, ¿no? Acá hay otra pregunta, ¿sí? Podemos reunir dos, tres tal vez, ¿sí? Y luego te doy la palabra. De acá se ve poco porque tengo una luz directamente en los ojos. Tengo acá una persona. Perfecto, aquí. Gracias por la luz.
Aquí no sé si escucha. Me llamo María Los Ángeles. No sé si la envidia y los celos la entendí perfectamente desde el punto de vista lacaniano, pero no sé si la envidia y los celos son prominentes de los gobiernos totalitarios. Yo creo que es más bien, no estoy hablando de partidismo, estoy hablando de política en general. Yo creo que más bien es producto y se ha exacerbado del sistema, más que de países, más que de gobierno. Aquí en Chile no tenemos un gobierno totalitario y creo, vivo y lo experimento, que la envidia y los celos están en aumento. Pero yo creo que es mucho más el sistema que nos lleva a esto que los gobiernos, siendo los gobiernos parte del sistema.
Perfecto. ¿Tenemos otra pregunta acá? ¿Sí? ¿Allá hay otra? Reunamos cuatro, ¿ya? ¿Les parece? Mientras sean breves, está todo bien.
Primero, muchas gracias por la presentación y preguntarle si desde su perspectiva la envidia y los celos son emociones que vienen con el ser humano predeterminadas o la sociedad es que hace que emerjan.
Y aquí tenemos acá una pregunta. Ah. Okay. Las dos últimas, sí, porque hay una niña también que está esperando, sí. Por favor.
Sí, me gustaría si puede desarrollar un poco más la idea de cómo concibe la relación usted también, no solamente Freud, entre envidia, no sé, ahí cómo jugaría el celo o los celos, y la justicia social. Si pudiera desarrollar un poco más eso.
Y la última pregunta directamente al lado tuyo, sí.
Hola, mi nombre es Fanny y me gustaría saber, dentro de todo el análisis que usted ha realizado, si acaso encuentra que exista algún aspecto positivo en tener algo de envidia o celo frente a persona, a la sociedad, a la política o a todos estos temas que hemos tocado en este minuto. Gracias. Sí,
perfecto, terminamos ahí. Hay varias preguntas que se cruzan, ¿no? Que son bastante como equivalentes. Tenemos unos, ¿sí? Okay. 8 minutos aproximadamente.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you to for all the questions about the social media. I think they very much play on these emotions. They are rising. They are introducing more and more, you know, these feelings, especially with the technical capacities that we can Photoshop our images, present, you know, our lives as much more perfect. They are introducing a lot of problems for people who are observing them. And it's very interesting, there was a research about young women who are observing the images of perfect bodies of others. You know, they are often feeling very self-critical, envious towards, you know, what others seem to have, beautiful lives, even when they know that it is kind of photoshopped or kind of fake, these images that they are observing. And those who are posting images of themselves are feeling even more unhappy. You know, those who are observing are already unhappy, thinking how the lives of others are better, but those who are posting their own images are constantly comparing their bodies, you know, their life and their happiness and so on with this kind of imaginary. And the shocking thing for me is the knowledge that how manipulated it is does not lower, you know, those feelings. And I think that, so they rely on the feelings of jealousy and also envy, because you really struggle with seeing so much enjoyment often, you know, in the photos, especially in Instagram and so on. So the question about social justice, I think here Freud really briefly touched this problem, which is, I think, very important, that this idea that there is a kind of a common social space, that actually, you know, we are limiting ourselves in the hopes that others will limit also themselves. And so social justice is a very, you know, kind of problematic thing, because it really relies on a certain kind of an idea of a common values, on common goals, on the ideas of communities. And I think that is nowadays even more lost than it was maybe a few decades ago. This idea, is there a community? Are there common values? And that's why I took the example of pandemics, which it looked at the start as if we are all on the same boat, in the same boat. This fantasy in the first weeks had the power. Very quickly, it disrupted. It fell apart. And I think that it was the mistakes of the way the leading the political powers were, you know, very early on starting profiting in, not only economically, also politically. In my own country, for example, the government used extreme measures preventing the opposition to demonstrate. At that time, we had, you know, kind of a government which was going in a more illiberal direction that people wanted. Happily, they lost the elections, but, you know, to use the virus as the way to prevent people to demonstrate, which is why we started bicycling every Friday. You know, the people started bicycling. You were allowed to exercise, but not to protest. So bicycling became a way of protest. Thousands of people were bicycling every Friday at 5 o'clock. Then the other questions were, do you still remember? I lost a little bit. I think the question was also about the importance of these feelings. I think that jealousy and envy, you know, are really important as a kind of moment of socialization, but it is, I think, we can see in the animal kingdom, you know, also in some way those kind of behaviors, you know, the competition among the puppies or whatever, you know. So we can see those, you know, rivalries also in the animal kingdom. I would say that in the human life, it is the way culture introduces, you know, a certain kind of, let's say, prohibition in regard to or encouragement of these feelings that we observe. That's where I think that ideology plays an important role. And consumerism definitely, you know, is kind of relying on envy. I want what someone else has. And of course, envy and jealousy, you know, I want what they have, but this idea of I want to destroy their enjoyment is also, I would say, very much politically present. Yeah, the question was also that it might not be linked only to authoritarian regimes. I agree. I think that it is not simply that in authoritarian regimes people have the feelings of envy. You know, in many countries, especially countries where you have a lot of corruption, I think that you can feel, you know, sort of the similar envy, which is linked also to self-criticism, where you kind of feel that you have not been skillful enough to gain profit, you know, in the system.
Perfecto, estamos llegando a la hora. Yo quiero, además de pedirle un aplauso a... Para Renata, sí, muchas gracias por venir. Solamente tocar pequeña, muy, muy brevemente el tema de Chile, ¿no? Sí, que no le podemos pedir a Renata que nos hable de eso, pero el mensaje yo creo que hay detrás de este de su comunicación es que finalmente ahí donde perdemos esta sensación, ¿no? La metáfora esta de estamos en el mismo barco, ¿no? Ahí donde se pierde la sensación de que tenemos algún grado de igualdad, ¿no? Y todos empiezan a saltar la fila, ¿sí? Aparece más la envidia, ¿no? ¿Sí? Aparentemente. Eso es como una de las imágenes más fuertes que viene. Decir la envidia está relacionada con cómo está estructurada la sociedad. Eso es el corazón del trabajo de Renata, ¿no? Como las emociones tienen que ver con cómo se estructura la sociedad, ¿sí? Y yo diría que estoy de acuerdo, ¿no? Un poco la envidia en nuestra sociedad... uno podría decir crece en la medida que se desestructuran todas aquellas instituciones, formas de establecer esa idea de que tenemos y merecemos igual trato, ¿sí? Tenemos o merecemos iguales oportunidades, ¿sí? Cuando se desestructura todo ese orden, ¿no? Aparece tal vez con más fuerza esta idea de la envidia, de que el otro está disfrutando algo que yo también quiero disfrutar, pero no me atrevo, no puedo, etcétera. Thank you. Un mensaje interesante, sin duda. Muchas gracias, Renata. Thank you.